Hi, everyone. I'm Ronnie.
And I'm Jessica.
And you're listening to Clean With Me,
the podcast where we walk you through cleaning your house.
Thanks for joining me. In today's episode, I'm going to talk you through cleaning a bathroom. So it's time to gear up for your cleaning session. Maybe there's something you want to do before you start getting your bathroom cleaning supplies together, like straightening up the front entrance of your home, or starting a load of laundry, or even just freshening up for the day, and maybe changing into some cleaning clothes. When you're deep cleaning a bathroom, oftentimes you're on the floor, on your hands and knees, and even using products that contain bleach. So for that reason, you don't want to clean your bathroom in your good clothes. Hopefully you have something designated to clean in. Usually I clean in regular clothes. Sometimes I put an apron on, but when I'm cleaning the bathroom, I'm wearing some old clothes, okay, so that I can really get in there. And I'm not talking about when I'm just touching up the bathroom, but I'm talking about when I'm on my hands and knees, scrubbing the base of the toilet and the baseboards and things like that. I like to wear some old clothes. So it's time to gear up for your cleaning session, whatever that means for you. And of course, you may want to get your cleaning supplies together. You might use disinfecting wipes. You might use a mop, or you might use the pre-moistened mop pads. I know in my smaller bathroom, I clean the floor by hand because it's such a small area. But in my bigger bathroom, I actually use a mop. You're going to need some kind of glass cleaning spray or multi-surface spray that works on glass, probably some microfiber cloths, scrubbing tools, toilet bowl cleaner, a toilet bowl brush. Maybe you wear gloves and a mask while cleaning the toilet. You know which kind of cleaning supplies you use. Often I use something that is designed to whiten when I'm cleaning my bathtub and my sink basins. I use something else on the countertops. You know what you use. Do whatever you need to do to get ready for your cleaning session, which of course includes getting the supplies together. Another thing you may need to do is empty your bathroom waste basket and reline it, or if it's not lined, take it outside and power wash it with the hose and maybe a little bit of dish soap or some other cleaning product or disinfectant. While you're doing whatever you need to do to gear up for your bathroom cleaning session, I just wanted to say special thanks to our financial supporters. And maybe you're not supporting the show financially. That's okay. I don't expect you to. Just listening to the show helps, especially when you click follow or subscribe on whichever podcast app or other platform that you listen on. That helps us greatly. But I do think you will benefit from additional episodes. And that's where supporting us comes in, because if you support us at any level, you gain access to bonus episodes, okay? And you can find out about the different ways to support the show by visiting cleanwithmepodcast.com or clicking on the link in the episode description. But you can support us using the Purple Podcast app that is called Apple Podcasts. A lot of people don't even know what it's called, but it's that purple app that came pre-downloaded on your iPhone. If you don't have an iPhone, there are a couple other ways to support us. There's a Spreaker link in the description. If you join the supporters club through Spreaker, it'll provide a link that directs you to a website where you can watch the bonus episodes. You can also support either Jessica or myself on Patreon. In the Patreon app, you'll be able to listen to the episodes. And there are also little pictures and videos that we post in there. So you'll gain access to some of that depending on which level you support us at. But by supporting us at any level, you will gain access to all of our bonus episodes. Some of them are me, some of them are Jessica, kind of like with the regular episodes, but we get a little bit more personal. We go a little more in depth in those episodes. And I feel that, you know, to get kind of the complete system, you really ought to try our bonus episodes. And you can even do a free trial if you're doing it on the Purple Apple Podcast app. So now that I've gotten that little commercial out of the way, let's get into cleaning your bathroom. Okay. You're going to want to clear anything off the floor, of course. Maybe you need to wash your bath mats or rugs. Maybe you have towels or dirty laundry on the bathroom floor that you need to pick up. No judgment here. You can't control everybody in your house. Or maybe you've even gotten into a rut if we're in your master bathroom that nobody ever sees. Maybe you're dropping clothes on the floor. Now's the time to get everything picked up and maybe even start a load of laundry. Okay, you might want to start a load of towels and rugs and things like that. When I wash a load of all towels, I like to put a little bit of white vinegar in the load to make sure that, you know, everything comes out smelling fresh and whatnot. I don't really like to mix my towels and rags in with my clothing, but sometimes when you're in survival mode, you know, you're throwing some towels and underwear all together. I get that. But maybe you need to start a load of laundry. Maybe you even want to wash your shower curtain. I don't know. Speaking of picking up your bathroom floor, maybe you've got little things that have been dropped and kind of rolled up under the countertop, okay? Some of you are just touching up or deep cleaning a tidy bathroom, but some of you, your bathroom's a disaster. You know who you are. No judgment here, but you might have little things on the floor that kids have dropped or whatever, and you need to pick those up. Now, before we get too far into the cleaning session, I recommend putting a toilet bowl cleaning product in your toilet bowl, giving it a swish, and then letting that chemical sit in the toilet bowl and do its work. Okay, by giving it a swish, I mean using your toilet brush to get that product up under the rim of the seat and to just make sure that the toilet bowl is coated with that product. You might be using a dedicated toilet bowl cleaner, which those are handy because they have kind of that neck that reaches up under the rim and applies that chemical where it needs to go. Or maybe you're in frugal mode right now and you're using like Ajax or Comet, which are bleach powders. Sprinkling that in. Whatever you use, just the important thing is not to mix two different products in your toilet bowl because that could result in a deadly chemical, basically. One time I used two different toilet bowl cleaners and realized I had made that mistake. And I ran out of the bathroom in a hurry and then I went back in with my face covered, quickly flushed it. Don't try this at home, folks. Don't do what I did. Just use one product. If a product's almost gone or whatever, you know, just use what's left of it. Don't mix a different brand because it might have a different active ingredient. Okay. And of course, if you have a window that opens in your bathroom, open it for ventilation purposes. Or if you have one of those internal bathrooms that does not have a window, then you just keep your door open, you know, to kind of keep some fresh air, but still you can't mix chemicals. Okay. So I like to get that toilet bowl cleaner doing its work. And then I turn my attention to other areas of the bathroom and then go back to the toilet near the end. The very last step is the floor, of course. So once I get that toilet bowl cleaner coating the inside of the toilet bowl, that's when it's time for me to turn my attention to the vanity area, okay? The countertop, the sinks, and then the mirror, okay? And probably also your bathroom cabinets need wiping down too, okay? So typically, I'll put everything away. There are things that go in drawers or in the cupboard under your bathroom sink or somewhere else, but I put everything away that just doesn't belong. Okay. You may have just some stuff spread out on your bathroom countertop. You may have things that just don't belong, but for some reason you put them there, or someone else put them there. Put those where they go. But even the items that perpetually belong on your bathroom countertop, like a soap dispenser or soap dish or toothbrushes or, you know, whatever else, a plant or other decoration, you want to set those aside. Okay. Oftentimes, the most tedious part of cleaning is just that preliminary tidying, that pre-clean that you've got to do. But the pre-clean is super important in the bathroom because you're going to be, you know, disinfecting everything. You're going to be spraying stuff. You've got to get everything out of your way. Of course, you don't want to spray a cleaning product around your toothbrushes. Okay. Some of this is obvious, but I do have young people listening who are just learning to clean. So I try to cover everything. So often once I get all the pre-cleaning done, the floor is clear, the countertop is clear, I will apply something to the sinks and scrub those. I'm not going to talk about the bathtub and shower much. If you've been listening to my show for a while, you know that I typically clean my bathtub and shower during a separate cleaning session. I like to scrub my bathtub as I'm getting out of it and draining it, and then I'll scrub it. And then I might even jump in the shower after having taken a bath and then clean my shower, just because, you know, you're already undressed or whatever, and, you know, it doesn't matter if you're getting wet or whatever. It's just easy. I like doing it that way. When I do want to clean the bathtub while I'm still clothed and I'm not planning to take a shower for whatever reason, I use a scrubbing tool that's on a pole, and that way I don't have to do too much bending. But when I'm inside the bathtub or shower, I use just a little handheld tool to scrub with while I'm in there. So I'm not really going to get into that in this episode, but often when I do the regular bathroom cleaning that I'm covering in this episode that focuses on the vanity area and the toilet and the floors, I will make sure that I have my bathtub and shower stocked with cleaning products and cleaning tools, and then that will make it easy for me to combine cleaning a bathtub or shower with my bath or shower, if that makes sense. But for now, you're going to want to apply a chemical to the sinks, coat it, let it sit for a while, and then maybe while those sinks are, you know, while the chemicals are doing their work in the sinks, you might want to wipe down your faucets and the vanity top itself, the countertop, if you will. Okay. And then I'll go back after I've wiped down the countertop, sprayed and wiped it down. I'll go back and rinse out the sink basins and, you know, make sure those are looking good. Okay. And I know I can talk faster than you can clean. Okay. You don't have to be doing exactly what I'm saying at the same time that I'm saying it. Once the bathroom countertop and sink and faucets have been scrubbed, the next thing I'll do, and don't shine up your hardware on your faucets just yet. I save that for the end after cleaning the mirror. The next thing I will do is clean the mirror. Okay. And in my bathroom, I may even stand up on top of the countertop to do that, to clean this huge mirror. I still haven't gotten the like squeegee that's kind of on a pole. I'm planning to do it. I just haven't done it. So at this point, I'm climbing up there, not as we speak, but the way I'm cleaning my master bathroom lately, where it's a huge mirror, I'm climbing up on the countertop and I'm using a Windex and microfiber cloth. Okay. And kind of the secret to having it streak free is to keep rubbing it even after you think it's dry, to just keep going over it with that microfiber cloth to eliminate any streaks. You've got to get it wet enough with the product at first, but don't stop right when you dry it off. You've got to keep on wiping and maybe even use a second microfiber cloth during that second drying process. It may sound like I'm obsessing, but the way the sunlight comes into my bathroom, the mirror is really unforgiving if I don't clean it right. Because there's a large window by the bathtub and you can't see people taking a bath. It's that mottled glass, but it lets tons of light in, which I like. I like all the light, but it's pretty unforgiving. So I'm going to give you a few minutes to clean that mirror. If you're in a smaller bathroom, cleaning the mirror is super quick. And of course, after I clean the mirror, that's when I like to shine up the actual faucets with that same microfiber cloth that I used on the mirror. You know, at this stage, I've already scrubbed the faucets, but then I want to, you know, shine them up as a finishing touch. If you need more time to clean your mirror and faucets because it's a huge bathroom, you may need to pause the episode. The next thing I want to talk about before I have you start scrubbing the interior and exterior of your toilet and then cleaning floors is decluttering, okay? In your bathroom, you may have drawers. I call them makeup drawers, even though we have different drawers for different things. In my master bathroom, I've got lots of drawers. 8 drawers and 2 cabinets, to be exact. So I have a lot of storage in there. So there's no excuse for me to leave much on the bathroom vanity at all. There's drawers for different things. There's drawers for my husband's like hair clippers. There's drawers for Q-tips. There's drawers for makeup and so on. And then in the cupboard, in one of the cupboards, I have a little basket that I use for different curling irons and flat irons, blow dryers and stuff like that. And yes, I typically have my favorite curling iron just perpetually out, but it does get put away when I'm actually cleaning the bathroom. And different people have different standards in that area. In a tiny bathroom, it could be irritating to someone in the family if there's, you know, curling irons and things and makeup out. But sometimes in a larger bathroom, it's okay. And it just depends on the standard of organization that you have or just your tolerance for things. But I'm definitely okay with keeping a curling iron out because let's face it, when you're done with it, it's hot. You let it cool. You leave the house while it's, you know, still sitting there or whatever. I get it. But sometimes out of necessity, you have to put everything away because you don't have a lot of counter space. And I understand that too. But let's talk about decluttering. Maybe you have all these drawers and cabinets, or maybe you just have baskets or, you know, boxes, shelves. But let's talk about decluttering. Do you need to get rid of any brushes? I mean, if you have a brush where those little balls on the end of the bristles have all come off, maybe toss that brush. I'm not tender-headed, but my kids definitely don't like using brushes like that. Combs usually last until they start, you know, losing teeth or whatever. But maybe you need to toss a broken comb or something. Hair accessories, hair products. Do you have hair products that you don't use? Could you pass them on to someone who could use them? Possibly. One thing I love about having 3 daughters is when it comes to things like makeup, hair products, if something doesn't work for me, often I can pass it to one of my daughters so it doesn't go to waste and then I don't have guilt when I'm experimenting with a lot of different products. And you can even use a shampoo you don't like to clean something around the house, okay? Be creative. Razors, you may need to toss some used razors that are accumulating somewhere. I mean, sometimes I think the nature of a bathroom is we're getting ready right before leaving the house. So sometimes we don't deal with things in the way that we should because like in the kitchen, we might go, oh, I'm done with this or this is no good. I'm going to toss it because we're not always in a hurry in the kitchen. Whereas in the bathroom, we're usually, you know, getting ready to leave the house or something when we're using things like brushes and combs and razors and things like that. Let's see, manicure and pedicure supplies. You have some old nail polishes you can toss. Decluttering should be incorporated into your cleaning sessions. you know, make it a way of life. If you look at decluttering as something just you do once in a while, it can be kind of a daunting task, whereas just quickly going through the drawers and seeing what you can toss is pretty effortless. Okay, cosmetic bags. If you have like one of those subscriptions like to Ipsy or some other beauty subscription, maybe they're giving you like free cosmetic bags and they're just starting to build up in your drawer. That was me for a while. But I started kind of a tradition of making little care packages for my daughters where I'd give them a few products and I'd give them a bag with those products. Okay. So maybe you want to give them to somebody. Maybe you want to toss them. What about soaps, lotions? One idea I have for lotions, I like to have a lotion in every vehicle. Just sometimes I want to put some hand lotion on, like on my way to church or something. So that's what I do with extra lotions is I'll have them in the car. I mean, you want them to be the kind that seal up and aren't going to just like squirt out if it expands due to heat or whatever. But if it's got a good screw-on lid, put it in the car. Other items that might, you know, lead to clutter, contact lens supplies, glasses, sunscreen, bug spray. I'm reading off a list here, folks. Other toiletries, medications. We don't keep any medications in the bathroom. We keep them up high in the kitchen. Band-aids, other medical items. Let's talk about toilet paper. I like to keep a basket on the back of the toilet and keep it stocked with extra rolls of toilet paper. And I've been known to just build a toilet paper pyramid on the back of the toilet. I don't want a guest or even my husband to have trouble finding another roll of toilet paper. So I like to have some visible extras. That might not be your style, but just a thought there. Cleaning supplies. You definitely want to keep your bathroom stocked. Now, obviously, disclaimer, if you're running a daycare or you have kids who are toddlers or preschoolers who might get into cleaning products, you might not be able to keep cleaning products where you use them. But if you're past that stage or nobody's going into bathrooms unsupervised, it can be convenient to have the supplies in the bathroom rather than in a central location in your house. Okay, but obviously safety rules apply. Robes, maybe you have a bathrobe hanging up and you need to throw that in the wash. You can't just never wash it. Okay. And of course, you might want to replace your bath towels and your hand towel and your washcloths and things like that. And you may even have like a linen shelves in your bathroom where you keep sheets and whatnot. I know some bathrooms are set up that way. We did have a bathroom that was designed to keep our linens on the shelves. We didn't really use it that way, but we did roll up the towels and display them there, along with other products. So hopefully you've tossed a few things that you found in a drawer or cabinet that you didn't need, or maybe put them in your donation box. I talk about this a lot, but I believe in having a donation station, meaning you don't have to make this like special time of decluttering to donate things. You just have like a box in the back of a closet where you put donatables as you are going through your day and you come across things. That definitely helps with the minimalism. And no, I'm not an extreme minimalist, but I also can't handle as much stuff as some other people can. Dana White from A Slob Comes Clean, another podcast, talks about your clutter threshold. Some of us have peace of mind when we get rid of stuff and we don't have as much stuff. There's another term called decision fatigue where, you know, you have too many clothes to wear or whatever. And I don't think it's really with me. I don't think I suffer from decision fatigue, but I don't like having to move things that I never wear to find the things that I do wear. But this episode is not about decluttering your wardrobe. I'm just talking about minimalism in general. You may have a box for things that you declutter, whether it's clothing, toiletries, whatever. Stuff that's still good, I mean. There's obviously stuff that needs to get tossed. And just like you're getting rid of stuff from your bathroom, you may need to restock certain items that maybe you have elsewhere, or maybe you need to buy certain items and now would be the time to like add them to your grocery list app or your notepad app, wherever you keep track of your list. You might want to add certain cleaning products or shampoos, conditioners, razors, what have you, to the list. Let's head to the toilet. It's time to clean all parts of your toilet inside and out. You might want to remove the lid, or you might just get in there and scrub those hinges and around those. I like to use disinfecting wipes for all of the exterior parts of the toilet. The seat, behind the seat, the rim. I don't cross-contaminate. I like to clean the flusher handle and the top of the seat that I sit on first, and then kind of go from there, okay, to where I'm ending at the bottom, the base of the toilet, and the floor around it, okay? And by cleaning the area around the bottom of the toilet by hand, it eliminates the problem of trying to get a mop back there, okay? So when I'm cleaning the base of my toilet, I'm cleaning the floor around it, the baseboard, the wall, all of that area. It gets really dusty and grimy back there. I'm cleaning all of that. And I'll admit, there are times when I'm in survival mode where I'm just sanitizing the toilet and I'm not always getting on my hands and knees and cleaning the very base of it. But you need to do that regularly. If somebody gets sick and they're just, you know, bowing down to the porcelain throne or whatever, they are going to see how dirty it is down there, okay? And it's easier to clean. Like with anything, it's easier to clean when you keep up on it and there's no buildup. So I encourage you to really get down there and clean the bottom of your toilet and around it. And of course, you're going to finish scrubbing out your toilet bowl. You may even need a pumice stone if you have hard water or just discoloration for any reason. You may need a pumice stone. And in our area, it's a thing. There's a maid that cleans my husband's office at his place of business every week, and she still needs to use a pumice stone because the water is so hard here. Okay, that's with just a consistent weekly toilet scrubbing. She finishes it with one of those pumice stones on a stick. So it's a thing here. Don't judge me if you're like, wow, if you get a ring, it's been too long. No, it kind of depends on the area you live in. Once your toilet bowl is completely clean, it may be time to clean the floors, but there might be a few things to take care of first. For example, if I was in my small bathroom, I would just use one of the, you know, pre-moistened Swiffer mop pads and just wipe the floor down by hand and kind of mop myself out of the bathroom, so to speak. And I would hit the baseboards and the floor kind of in one fell swoop and kind of grab up any debris, kind of like how you would wipe down a kitchen countertop after making a sandwich, how you're grabbing up the crumbs. I kind of do that in the kids' bathroom, to where I'm combining the sweeping and mopping just in one fell swoop. It's a super tiny bathroom. But in my bathroom, I would sweep and then mop. But before sweeping and mopping in my bathroom, there's a window, so I would clean the windowsill. Okay, that gets dusty, and I like to hit that with a fresh disinfecting wipe. And I would also oftentimes, you know, some things you don't do every week or every couple weeks, but wiping down baseboards. But sometimes I actually clean my baseboards just with the string mop when I'm cleaning the bathroom floor. That's a quick way to do it. And of course, you kind of start at the area around the toilet and mop yourself, sweep, and then mop yourself out of the bathroom. But again, in a tiny bathroom, you might be able to combine the sweeping and mopping step by using like a damp towel with some disinfectant on it or one of those pre-moistened pads, okay? But lately in my bathroom, I'm using a string mop, and I also often mop my shower tiles, okay? Because I have these shiny tiles, and I got a question about this recently from one of our platinum level supporters. And it was, you know, how do you clean these shower tiles and, you know, make them shiny without making them dull? Everybody's, you know, tiles are different, I guess, but ours, I use the Swiffer mop, and then I put, you know, the pre-moistened pad on it and scrub the shower tiles with that. I either do that or I spray them with a Windex that has the vinegar in it. Okay. And that works. I've even been known to use the string mop, but I like taking a mop to the shower walls. It's just fast and efficient. Regardless of which cleaning product you use on your shower walls, consider using a mop if you've got, you know, tile going up to the ceiling or something. And I mentioned that I do my showers and bathtubs separately, but the exception is when I'm just shining up those tiles, I sometimes combine that with my mopping session. Let's talk about clear glass shower doors. I'm not going to belabor this or spend a lot of time on this, but I get the hard water off with vinegar and an abrasive sponge, and then I follow that with a glass cleaner or a Windex. I'm not going to take long on this because, again, I like to clean my shower and bathtub separately from my bathroom cleaning session, but I do want to share a tip with you. My 2-year-old grandson took a Sharpie to my glass shower doors, and someone told me that I could draw over the mark with a Sharpie and wipe it off. That did work, but there were so many scribbles, I wasn't about to trace the whole thing. So what I ended up doing, and this was the same person's idea, was I used nail polish remover. I used one of the heavy duty nail polish removers that does have the acetone and everything. And I used that to clean the permanent marker off of the glass. So this would work on a window or shower door if you've got an artist, a budding artist, just, you know, tagging up your house. It'll probably be more challenging if they write somewhere else, but it was easy to get it off the glass using the nail polish remover. And then I followed that with a glass cleaner to make sure, you know, my glass wasn't all fogged up or whatever. Again, be careful mixing chemicals. I did what I did, but I'm not a chemist, so be careful. And obviously, I had wiped off the nail polish remover before I applied the next chemical. Once you're done cleaning your bathroom floors, it's time to put everything back and make sure you've got, you know, fresh towels, toilet paper, the toothbrushes are back where they go, the soap's back where it goes, and so on. Don't forget to do a laundry switch later if you've got some stuff in the washing machine. I hope you got a lot done during this episode, and happy cleaning. I'll talk to you soon.